Friends, we are going to start now. Today's topic is GST, Goods and Services Tax from the Consumer Perspective. This is the book. It's in a comic form, wonderfully made. So he's going to speak on this entire this thing, and is forwarded by not less than our Finance Minister Arun Jaitley. Thank you very much, Srinivas. You are here and immediately accept this thing. 45 minutes of speech and 15 minutes question answer, then cup of tea. This is a regular. Before that, we have introduction one by one. So G.Seshagiri Rao.
Rahul Sharma.
Ajit Pulsare.
Shikhar Pritchha.
Neeraj Srivastava. Ashutosh Kumar Srivastava.
Shyam Sundar Gupta.
Agarwal.
Rahul Agarwal.
Uma Patak.
नाम बताओ
अच्छा अच्छा मैंने
Myself, my name is Srinivas Kotni. So I've been in this practice for the last 20 plus years. And I run a law firm from Delhi and Bangalore. And my major area of practice is trade laws, of which GST is a very important constituent. So I've been looking at indirect taxes very closely for a long period of time. From a litigation perspective, and I've been advising mostly companies in their litigation, compliances, opinions, etc. on various intricacies of the tax laws, indirect taxation laws. So, I'm first of all very grateful to Sheshu Garu for this opportunity to be among the friends of the bar, and it's like homecoming for me. I'm a member of the group also, and I'm so very happy that in the afternoon, summer afternoon, you have made yourself available to have this interaction. And I would rather like this session, if I'm permitted to do a little modification. What I would want is that I would want to make it interactive. So as and when you have questions, instead of waiting for the last 10-15 minutes, you can raise there and I can clear it then and there, because the context would demand and participative in nature. So, before talking about GST, I should talk about what a tax is. A tax is a financial levy by the government to fund various public expenditures. It's as simple as that. So, a nation cannot progress or go ahead without collection of taxes. And the outlay of those taxes in the budgets, the finance minister is at the helm of it, and he has got a huge team throughout the country. And there are two different wings. One is direct tax wing and indirect tax. So therefore, I am trying to make it as, because I understand that many of you are not practitioners of tax law. You may be coming from civil, criminal, other jurisdictions, but there is no escape of from tax. Even a beggar, if he goes to the market and buys a matchstick, he has to pay GST. So therefore, it touches everybody in the entire ecosystem in the country. So this tax, as I said, is one is direct tax. Direct tax, the levy and incidence is both on the same person. It's on income, it's on property, etc. But when it is on goods, transactions relating to goods or services, it becomes indirect tax. So in indirect tax, what happens? Levy is on one person and the incidence is shifted to another person, which is the consumer. Ultimately, indirect taxes touch the consumer. So it's only the chain of collection and passing on, and ultimately the consumer has to bear the brunt. So therefore, whenever there is a change in rates in indirect taxes, normally consumers are the ones which come in your mind. So, I mean, it is the concept of the these two kinds of taxes. Now let us talk about why the need for GST. And before GST, what was happening? So we had number of indirect taxes. There were about 16 taxes which were subsumed into GST. So these taxes were levied on something called taxable events. There were various taxable events. So this all comes in the constitution, right? And we have entries also, right? List 1, list 2, list concurrent list, etc. So what the central government can levy, what the state governments can levy, and both of them. So therefore, what are those taxable events? For example, there used to be central excise duty. For that, the taxable event was manufacture. If you have a factory, if you manufacture something and that goods are removed from the factory, you pay something called central excise duty. So that was an indirect tax. That central excise duty, though the manufacturer is paying at the first instance, ultimately it will go to the consumer, right? And the moment the goods are removed from the factory, right? So there are two taxes which are to be paid fundamentally at that point of time. Excise and sales, because there was another taxable event which was triggered, which is sales. So the moment there is a sale, you have what is called sales tax. The sales tax also has got two variants, because India is a federal structure, right? There are different states. There is movement of goods, movement of services also. Right now we are talking about goods. So whenever the goods are moving from state A to state B, the interstate movement, right? That only the central government could have levied the tax then, before GST, right? So that was called central sales tax. There was CST Act, Parliament has passed the act, and every state in the year 2003 to 2005, all the states have brought in something called VAT laws, which is value added tax laws. So this VAT concept is international concept. So why is VAT concept is required? I'll tell you. Because there is something called cascading effect. I mean, I just want to simplify it for you. When you manufacture something, you pay excise duty and sales tax, right? That is taken to state, say Assam. From Assam, it is sold to some other state or locally, and the local VAT is applied on that. Then there's entry tax also in between, right? And there are various other kinds of indirect taxes. So if value-added nature is not there, there's always a possibility and an imminent possibility that a tax on tax is collected unintentionally. And when tax on tax is also collected, the end product becomes too expensive for the consumers. And that is the reason why world over VAT has been adopted in different forms. For example, France adopted in 1953 GST for the first time. And thereafter many European countries followed and all. And we had to wait till 2017 to bring in GST. So, but then this value-added concept was adopted in sales tax laws in 2003. As far as excise is concerned, they adopted it in 86 by something called pro forma credit. So therefore, you buy inputs, you manufacture, you sell output. So all inputs are tax-paid inputs. If you don't give the credit of the input tax, then that particular value also gets subsumed into the final product, and you're ending up paying tax on tax. So therefore, the concept was then modified to something called mod VAT, right? Then the CENVAT came. So therefore, this is how your tax jurisprudence has developed. The Parliament has, in its wisdom, in a modified manner, put the value-added concept in excise separately, VAT separately, but there was no interlinkage. Now, I want to complicate that situation a little more. When you're importing, it's a different taxable event. So when you're importing any goods from anywhere in the world, what is a taxable event? What is a levy? Import duties, which are customs duties. There are different types of customs duties. One is the basic custom duty. Then, in order to countervail the excise, to give the level playing field to the imported goods vis-a-vis the domestically manufactured goods, they used to levy something called additional duty of customs, which is also called countervailing duty. Right? Then, because sales tax also is applied in India if it is traded, so they said, okay, we want to countervail that also. So they said, okay, fine, we'll levy something called special additional duty. It was really sad. The short form is sad. So to countervail the sales tax. So all these things were happening. So there was too many acts to follow, too many rules to forms, too many registrations. The laws were not talking with each other. There was no inter-law, what you call, setting off possible. So all these things led to corruption, because you can't have a single system to control it, even from the government perspective. From the SSC perspective also, it is a problematic situation. From the consumer perspective, it is becoming expensive and expensive because you're paying taxes on taxes. And also for imports and exports also, these taxes were causing a lot of problem. Apart from the direct taxes, we are only talking about indirect taxes. So where we started at the factory gate. In the factory gate, we spoke about central excise duty, we spoke about central sales tax for interstate transactions, and in case the product being manufactured, for example, a television, is sold in the very same state, VAT was applicable. So therefore, that will go to a wholesaler. Then wholesaler will again sell to the retailer, retailer will sell to the consumer. So there's a chain for every product, whether it's an agricultural product, electronic product, information technology product, there's a chain. So therefore, you eventually, all these complications, India was watching world over what is happening. So we wanted to integrate all these things and to give an answer to the federal structure. It's a huge problem. We have many states and different governments, different political dispensations, and different, because earlier it was a source-based taxation, which wherever the transaction took place, that particular government would keep the taxes. Now, in a VAT kind of situation, in a GST situation, it's a destination-based consumption tax. What happens is that, though it is collected in the first instance, it is transferred to the state where the goods are ultimately consumed. So earlier, the governments were asking industries to be set up, trade to be being encouraged, etc. Why? Because that particular government was getting tax. You had tax-exempt zones, you had Himachal Pradesh, you had Uttarakhand, you had so many zones which were getting exemption status. Why? Because there was economic activity, there was employment, and also the tax which is collected would be remaining in that state, right? But then, this is a paradigm shift. So when the paradigm shift happened, the states started making hue and cry as to if Maharashtra is collecting, say, 50,000 crores of rupees of tax. Now, after GST coming in, what will happen? So therefore, the compensation issues were there, then settlement issues were there, right? So all these things led to the delay. I mean, you said 20 years or whatever. So it all is because of so many interest groups have to be combined, and then they have to be satisfied. So, but then they did it. Ultimately, in 2017, they brought in the goods and services tax. Now, the historical background why I wanted to give you is to see how the transformation happened. Because when we are talking about taxable events, entertainment, if you go out for a movie or a circus, it's also a service. So therefore, there was an entertainment tax, right? If the goods are entering from one state to other state, entry tax. If your goods are coming in from abroad, import duty. So all these taxes were creating this problem. So what is GST now, right? And we are talking about taxable events also, VAT, excise, customs duty, etc. And then comes the, in my book, like I call him a Superman, because I don't want to call him a Gabbar Singh. I want to keep him a Superman, because ultimately, whether you want it or not, it is going to stay. And we are bound with it, whether it's better to understand it and follow it. You have no escape with all the criminal prosecutions and a lot of penal provisions, fiscal penalties, etc. You better follow, whether it's a manufacturer, service provider, trader, everybody needs to follow it, right? Now, in GST, what is a taxable event? That's the question which I would expect from an intelligent audience like you. In GST, they've replaced all the what you call taxable events with a concept called supply. So what is supply is what is we need to understand. So supply means whenever there is transfer of goods or provision of services, you are attracting the levy of GST, right? It can be licensing, it can be sale, it can be hire purchase, it can be free gifting, it can be inter-unit transfer. All those things are supplies, and every supply will attract GST. Now I'll bring in that concept of interstate and intrastate. Now, because states have to be kept in mind, because it's a very good slogan, one nation, one tax. Do we have a one nation, one tax? No. Though it is, as compared to the olden days, it is much more simpler, much more straightforward, much more in control, right? But still, it's a little modified version of it. Why? Because we have one CGST. What is CGST? Central Goods and Services Tax. Then there is one SGST, that is State Goods and Services Tax. There is one IGST. What is IGST? integrated goods and services tax, right? And there is a fourth one, UTGST, Union Territory, right? The central government has passed acts regarding CGST and UTGST. All the states have passed the acts regarding the state thing. Integrated service tax also is levied. The act is passed by the union government. Later on, distribution happens. Now, the question you should ask is, which tax would come on which transaction? Right? So, should we take goods as an example or services as an example? Services. So, for example, there's services, you pick up the services, sir. Which services you want?
Education services.
So there is a university, right? A private university which doesn't give a diploma or degree recognized by law. Let us assume that. Now that university, when it offers courses, it attracts students, right? So it is providing services. It's giving infrastructure, it is giving teachers, it is giving so many things, diploma, etc., employability, etc. So that service would attract GST. So what is the GST which will be attracted? Because that there, the service recipient, right, is a service recipient only, and the service provider are in the same state. Say, for example, in Delhi or Ghaziabad. Ghaziabad, there's an institute. So the bill which is generated will carry two taxes. What? CGST and SGST. And it's equal rate. Let us assume 18% rate.
9 plus 9,
right? It is collected and distributed then and there. So therefore, the funniest part is that all the central excise offices throughout the country have been converted to CGST offices. And all the sales tax offices throughout the country have been converted to SGST offices. So that tug of war will remain, the different tribunals, the different advanced ruling authorities. So all that would get settled. But since we are talking about the transaction, on that transaction, what you described, the example, both the taxes would be applied because it's a intrastate transaction of provision of services. Now replace those services with goods also. Same thing will apply. If somebody, a parchun dukanwala, is selling some salt, right? Same two taxes would apply. Rates may vary, but normally you can keep it in your mind that 80% chances in terms of number of items is 18%, right? Whereas in Chanakya, he said 1/6. 1/6 means what? 16%. So we're not much off the mark. So even thousands of years back, 16% tax, he was saying that on all goods and services we should collect. I mean, the government should collect. So we are collecting 18% only, except some luxury goods and sin goods, as they call it, right? All the sin goods carry some 28%, right? And government is, I mean, the heart is there at the right place. I mean, in one of my chapters, the name of the chapter is that, heart at the right place, right? The exemptions given, I mean, basic use items, 0% is there, 5% is there. So it's a gradation, right? So we as citizens, we have to support as, we are officers of court also. So we have to interpret these laws to the court and also to advise the clients not to, try and play with the system. Like right now, I mean, a couple of days back, I was reading in the newspaper. They have formed innovative ways of evasion. There's one concept called input tax credit, because we're talking about value addition. At every level, the concept is that you pay tax only on the value you are adding. So if I am a cotton manufacturer, I purchase cotton, I do some refining, and if I am dealing in the cotton, right, so I pay some tax, I also collect some value, right, maybe 18%, right. That cotton is bought by somebody who manufactures yarn. Right, when that manufacturer of yarn purchases cotton, so he already is paying the value and also tax portion. Now that tax portion which he is paying will come and sit in his books as a credit. So it's a prepayment of tax. So when he is, that yarn, what he bought for 100 rupees, he may be selling the yarn for 200 rupees, same quantity. So there is a value addition of 100 rupees, right? So therefore he, on 200 rupees also 18%, it is 36 rupees. So out of his pocket, he'll only pay 18 rupees. 18 rupees would come from the first level. So this chain continues. So this will keep the entire thing transparent. And this is called the input credit chain. Okay. So on input credit, anybody wants to ask me any questions, please ask me. This is the most important concept. The entire value-added tax system, the entire GST system is sitting on this bedrock of input tax credit, which used to be called SENVAT credit in the earlier days. Right? Because the entire concept fails, because if all these exemptions and all these rate differentials, say for example cotton, processed cotton is, the rate of tax is 18%, on yarn it is 6% or 8%, sorry. Then you have accumulated credit, because you will not be able to use it, right? So all these situations, the refunds, etc., etc. For exporters, there is something called, it is called zero rated. You don't need to pay tax, GST, on goods which are going out of India. Why? The concept, right from Mahalanobis' time, right? Right from the time when India got independence and all that, the concept is that you export goods, not taxes. You export what? Goods or services, not taxes, right? So therefore, it is zero rated. But exported goods also are manufactured out of some inputs. That inputs would carry tax. So therefore, you have the concept of drawback, the concept of refund, and all these things. Okay. So therefore, we spoke about intrastate sales, right? We spoke about CGST, SGST, right? And if it's in the Union Territory, it will be UTGST. CGST plus UTGST. Those are trends. If you go to a restaurant, you're paying two taxes. You clearly observe it. There will be two taxes written, CGST and SGST. Now, but if it's a transaction, interstate transaction, can anybody give an example of an interstate transaction?
Selling of goods from Maharashtra to Gujarat.
Gujarat. So therefore, what do you think will apply? What will be applied on the transaction is one tax, which is called Integrated Goods and Services Tax, IGST, which used to be CST earlier, I mean, but that was only for sale. Now, there is no concept of sale, there is no concept of manufacture, there is no concept of import, there is no concept of entry, it's only supply. A is supplying to B, and that transaction, if it is between two states, it will attract IGST. Right? So therefore, that IGST also, that person can take credit. Now you can ask a question as to how the states will distribute it, right? That there's a mechanism like a stock exchange with the government. So that is how it is being settled. And that is why you have the GST council, right? What is the GST council? Because till date, there's never a council. In India, if tax rates are to be changed all along till 2017, Parliament has to pass a law, right? Every year there were amendments or tariff acts. And then we were looking at budget and all those things. Now this budget, indirect taxes, there was only one para. Mr. Jaitley spoke only one para. Because why? Because GST Council, the head of which is the finance minister, the members are all the finance minister of the states, right? They have been empowered by the constitution and by the acts, CGST Act, etc., to pass, take so many decisions regarding exemptions, regarding taxes, regarding procedures, regarding forms, everything. So therefore, Parliament is redundant as far as mechanization of GST. Why? Because it's a federal subject. Both are interested, center and state. So they had to have a common ground. What is the common ground? GST Council. So in my book, what I have, the simile which I used is angels. They're like angels. So they are trying to sort out the problems between the states. They are asking, you tell about what you want. You want to exempt something, you want to do something, you want to increase the rates, etc., etc. All those decisions are being taken by GST Council, right? So we have spoken about the intrastate transactions, we have spoken about the interstate transactions, IGST, right? The input credit mechanism will apply to all, right? There will be different brackets, which you need not bother as consumers, because I've been told to treat you as consumers and then talk, right? But still, I mean, since you're all lawyers, you may have to deal with some subject somewhere, so therefore I'm just transgressing from it here and there, right? The third aspect which I want to speak about in these transactions is import. When you import taxes, as I told you earlier, before GST, there was basic customs duty, which is a pure customs duty, and then there were countervailing duties, CVD to countervail excise duty, SAD to countervail sales tax, and then you had cesses, Swachh Bharat says, this says, that says, surcharges, right? So now what has happened is, after GST has come in, the basic customs duty continues. The basic customs duty is not a VATable item. There is no credit available of that. It's a cost, always a cost. If you are importing any goods, normally it is 10%, right? That is going to the exchequer. You cannot take as a credit, even if you're a businessman, if you're a trader.
later on you can't do any adjustment. But apart from that, this one levy which is there is IGST. Again, IGST has got two different roles. One in interstate transactions within the country and on imports, right? So therefore, whenever the goods are being imported into India, you file a bill of entry, you file an invoice, you file a packing list, and you employ a custom house agent who goes and does the documentation and clears those goods. And at the port, these duties are to be paid. So if the import is by a manufacturer, say for example, and the manufacturing plant is in Gurgaon or Neemrana, so that manufacturer can, based on the bill of entry, take credit of that IGST, right? And that IGST can be later on registered with his further taxes when he's in the chain, right? So any other any doubt, I mean, at this point of time, because this is the most basic thing that we understand. This everything else can be built up on this. So these are the, I mean, it's nothing but old wine in new bottle. There's nothing new. Actually, if you've studied excise laws, if you've studied service tax laws, sales tax laws, etc., it's a combination of all that, except that the taxable event has been changed. So you just have to think, where is the supply? And then there are concepts of time of supply, place of supply, etc. Because if you are levying a tax, when do you collect it? When do you file return? When the what is the last date for payment of tax, etc.? So therefore, because there can be invoice, you may be receiving advance, you may be issuing invoice, you may be providing services, receiving services or receiving goods, right? You may be returning. There are so many transactions happening in the commercial world. So therefore, the time of supply is very, very important to fix the legal liability to perform those obligations under the procedures of the rules, under the Act, right? So therefore, the law says the earliest of the dates is the time of supply, right? Whether it is, if you have gotten advance, that's the earliest, right? If you have not gotten advance, then there's a particular period within which you have to issue invoice, 30 days. So the date of issue of invoice is there. If you have not issued invoice, then when did you provide the service of purchase the goods, sell the goods, when the supply took place? If no information is available, when did you record it in your accounts? Right. So there's different levels of in the time of supply. So therefore, I mean, from the consumer perspective, a couple of things which are coming to my mind are when you go to a restaurant. Right. Recently, there have been some amendments. Earlier, it used to be 18% tax. If it's an AC restaurant with liquor, there was a higher rate. If it was non-AC, no liquor, lower rate and all that. All that has been, all that is gone. It's only 5% levy now. 5% for all restaurants wherever you go, right? Except hotels which charge 7,500 rupees and more, right? So if it's a big star hotel which is charging 7,500 rupees and more, and you go to that restaurant, then you pay higher tax of 18% or whatever, right? This is something which you can, and then also there are questions regarding when you pay a hotel bill, right? There's also service charges which are collected, which is not a, which is supposed to be going to the waiters, etc., for their welfare and all those things. Whether that is also part of consideration and all those things. Those are issues which will rake up in the days to come, right? Now, the other aspect which I wanted to speak about is all of us book flats, right? When we book flats, what is the GST applicable, right? So, it's a beautiful thing. When you are purchasing a flat or a house, it is transfer of property. And the house is not goods, it's not chattel, it cannot move, right? It is embedded into the earth. So therefore, it's not goods. So Goods and Services Act cannot apply to sale of property. Clear? So therefore, if you are buying a house which has got a completion certificate, it is already there and you're just buying the house, then there is no question of any GST. Clear? But if you're booking a house which is under construction, then you're taking construction services from the builder. So the law says, in that eventuality, you have to pay tax. Right now, that also they've classified. I mean, they've made it very, very affordable. Affordable housing, that is 60 square meters and below, right? You have a tax of 1%, and there'll be no input credit, mind it. either for restaurants or for houses. And if it is 60 meters and above, it's a non-affordable housing. You have to pay 5% on the value, right? And if it's a commercial property, it's a regular 18%. So this is for, as far as the houses are concerned, right? Now, any other aspects which you want me to address?
Just to simplify the, by giving the example, suppose the suppose a soap has been produced in Maharashtra.
Correct.
It has been sold and sent to for a sale for a Gujarat.
Correct.
From Gujarat, it went up to UP.
Correct.
What would be the tax structure and how it will
the
be?
The tax
itself?
Structure would be,
yes,
from when it goes from Maharashtra to Gujarat, right? IGST of 18% will be levied.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
That will be collected by the central government. And central government will also be keeping a watch on where the goods are moving, because invoice number is there with them, GST number is there with them. I'll talk about GST and after this, right? Then from Maharashtra, from Gujarat, it goes to
UP,
right? So the Maharashtra guy, he'll take credit of it. If he purchases for 100 rupees, he'll make some profit. He's there to make some profit. He may sell it for 130 rupees, right? On 100 rupees, 18 rupees as input credit is already sitting with him. Right, on 130, it may be a little more, it may be 24 or 25, right? The rest of the balance, 24 minus 18, 6 rupees, he'll pay out of cash from his pocket before selling it to UP in his invoice. So therefore, eventually he has paid 24 rupees, but 18 out of credit account and 6 out of cash. That is how the input credit mechanism works. And those goods, when they're moving from Maharashtra, Gujarat to UP, right, it's another transaction, another interstate transaction. Again, that will attract what? IGST. He may sell it for 200 rupees.
Then what about the price?
That person will take 24 rupees as credit.
Okay.
Look, you must understand that tax is tax, whether it is paid by credit or cash. For a recipient, he can book the entire amount as credit because the invoice will show tax paid 24 rupees. We don't care whether it is paid in cash or credit. The mechanics are required for the SSC, whether he should take out hard cash and pay or he can use the credit, right? But from a consumer perspective or from a common man perspective, the tax has no color, either money or credit. On the invoice, it is not written that I have paid 18 from credit account and 6 from cash account. That will be there in the SENVAT register, the GSTN, right? So the other example, which other concept which I want to talk about is, till date, I mean before GST came in, there were numerous departments. They were not talking with each other, right? Because they would never talk, because they, in the federal structure, they always be in some conflict. So therefore, there was rampant evasion. Yahan se maal liya, wahan le gaye. There's no trail, right? But today, there's a trail. There's only one information system which is built by Government of India with help of Infosys. And Mr. Nandan Nilekani was the first consultant. And what they are doing is, what they have done to a large extent, and why the teething troubles are, because it's a huge step to bring in GST, right? It's not a simple task. Even in our house, if you want to put a small system, it's a huge headache. But the whole country, and then with this federal structure, with different states, manufacturers, service providers, earlier people who were registered, non-registered, bringing them all to the system, then the system, what all does the system does? It allows you to pay tax. It allows you to submit your returns and documents. It allows the department to audit it. It allows the department to issue show cause notices. So the audit department is using, the assessment department is using, the consumer is using, the SSC is using. So all these things on one system, you can imagine. So what is happening today, I sit on a board of some, as an independent director of some multinational companies. Being a director, right, I am receiving emails every week that you have got so much of material, you have cleared so much of material, you have to pay so much of tax, you are not yet paid. Please pay tax on time. Just like that installment thing, whenever we need to pay that EMI, 1 week before it will come, please keep funds, like that it's coming. So it was never unimaginable earlier. Now this, I mean, they are working out you, to that finer level.
If you don't mind, in the previous example, where we have given the three states, production in Maharashtra, second sale is in Gujarat, third
correct.
Is in UP.
Correct.
What about the price of the ultimate product?
Price of the ultimate product would be market driven. It will depend on the demand and supply.
No, the price in Maharashtra would be different to UP.
Of course,
price in Gujarat.
Of course, it is. It will be different because the tax would keep adding. The margin would also keep adding.
Okay.
Price would definitely. How can the price remain same and tax apne jeb se dega nahi na? It's what is it? It's a destination based consumption tax. Jo consumer se lena hai humne. Ultimately, ye topi ghumti rahegi and ultimate. Consumer ke sar pe lag jayegi. That is the concept.
So
therefore the it will keep increasing. Only thing is that on value addition only each person will pay in the chain, right? And the GSTN takes care of all that. Of course there are so many problems and so many issues which are happening with the software and all that. That will be figured out. Now I would want to read certain statistics which may, as consumers, help you, because which I can't remember.
Is there any limitation for claiming input tax and input credits?
1 year.
1 year.
Before filing your annual return.
Or adjusted in the next.
No. It is to be claimed. It is to be claimed before you file your annual return. That is the limitation.
And what are the formalities related to GST interstate?
Interstate. It is. I mean,
from one state to other.
The formalities are the same because you, if you are registered with IG, I mean, with the central CGST authorities, that registration will apply for everything. It's a single registration. Registration
barriers
is single.
Are not there.
Huh?
Barriers are not there.
There's no barriers. If you are a person who are having your establishment in Delhi, either for sale of goods or for provision of services, you take a registration in Delhi, right? If you have and 10 offices in Delhi, then also you have only one registration because it is state-wise, right? And if you have an office in Ghaziabad and other 10 more offices in Uttar Pradesh, there will be one registration for Uttar Pradesh because the state is involved, na? Its yes. Revenue is involved.
Now, I am manufacturing in Delhi.
Correct.
Selling in Bihar or UP.
Correct.
Whether registration, Delhi registration.
No, where are you selling? Is the person coming and buying it in Delhi? Or you have established a shop there and then selling it. So it depends upon whether you, it's the same income tax concept. So if you have a shop there, you better take registration there also. Then you, what you do is, when you send these goods, you'll send them under a document called stock transfer invoice. That stock transfer invoice is also an invoice on which you pay IGST. It's also supply. I said free of cost also if you want to give goods. For example, Coca-Cola company, it gives goods to its employees. Right, as a crate of Coca-Cola for their marriage, etc. They have to jolly well pay GST on that. There is no escape. Earlier consideration was important. Now the consideration is irrelevant. The transaction of supply is there, then you pay tax. If you don't have a consideration, look, another thing is that it's always transaction value. The value on which you pay all these GST is transaction value normally, unless the two people are related or apart from price, there is some other consideration. Hey, 1000 rupees bhi de do, ek purani TV bhi de do mujhe. Then somebody would sit and value that purani TV and then add that to it. Then on the cash value plus that TV value, you pay tax at 18%. Right? But if you are transaction between two brothers, they'll say what is the market value of that? They'll find other transactions which are arm's length and then apply that rate to this. So all these things are covered under the valuation provisions.
Applies for online transactions.
Everything. And online transactions is a very interesting thing. There's a concept called TCS, tax collection at source, only for online transactions. So they collect 1 or 2% like TDS, right? And there's one more thing. There's an aggregate turnover which is required for exemption. 40 lakhs is a limit beyond which you have to take registration in GST. Online transactions, there's no limit, number one. Number two, the responsibility for collection and payment of tax lies with the aggregator. For example, Uber. Uber is not owning one single taxi. There are thousands of taxis which are plying. But then the government says, we don't want to catch hold of all those taxi drivers, all those mom and pop shops. You Flipkart Mr., you Uber, or whatever, whether you're small or big, you are the person who's going to be liable for paying tax. And how you organize your affairs with your smaller fellows is your problem. That's the law. For online transactions.
So here one interesting question. I am registering with Flipkart for selling my items.
Correct.
I have my GST registration at Delhi.
Huh.
Whether tax now I will pay to the government.
That transaction, look, it's a supply. I'm sorry for interrupting you, but I understood your question. It's a supply. You have given it to Flipkart. just to sell it, right? Now Flipkart may sell it, I mean across the state or within the state, same things will apply. Same things will apply. That is tax collection at source, TCS.
No, but if it is passing through the two states, like Flipkart, something comes.
Look,
from
passing
Bangkok.
Through is not a problem.
Okay.
It's only destination.
States will not get anything.
Last destination will.
Haan. Earlier they used to get entry tax. Bhaiya, mera road use kar rahe ho, mera infrastructure use kar rahe ho, entry tax.
Ah, I know.
Now it is gone.
Okay.
Because it applies to everybody. And that is the reason why there is a compensation cess act, compensation act, GST compensation act. So if any state, because of bringing in of GST, is losing some revenue, the GST council has said that they'll all put together, they're charging some money on account of alcohol and tobacco and all that, and that cess would be used for compensation.
How about the software?
For 2 years.
When the company provides software solutions, like how do you manage the GST?
Software.
I have developed a software and
correct.
It goes intangible.
How it, intangibles are also taxable, it is service. Intangibles
user,
are service.
Who use it, there taxable event.
Correct.
User
look, the moment you supply it, you give a license
yes.
or you let them to download, there is some supply is happening.
Hmm.
All that is part of supply. And the moment you invoice, you are caught in the GST thing.
You said even free. Now when we download an app, it is free to us.
But then that is typically
it's
speaking.
It's a service somebody is making.
It's a very interesting. It's a very interesting question, but it should be taxable. I mean, it should be taxable.
You never know where it was produced.
Look, there are forensics today available to
hackers lab, and you get a
there are forensics. The IP address, etc. The IT has gone way ahead, and it can be tracked. These transactions can be tracked easily.
You want to ask one question?
But we download from
one
the Play Store also.
Rahul,
that is
Rahul,
also this.
Play Store is played.
Yeah.
That is no. That is no.
Free of cost. Sorry.
Ask further.
Just for example, suppose I purchase a flat in housing society.
Correct.
Every month builder wages maintenance pay.
Correct.
The moment I start is adding there.
Correct.
That maintenance bill includes the electricity charges, water, common area charges, security guard charges, etc. Whether residents are liable to pay.
Of course, yes.
Huh?
Of course, yes.
No, it's by in-house exercise.
No, but then you there's a supply of certain services.
It's not a commercial thing. We are
no.
living together.
No, commercial.
And managing affairs.
No, actually, you are saying.
I have paid for it.
Like mutuality.
RW.
But you are registered.
Why should we pay
no,
tax?
Look, there is no question. Look, first of all, let us first understand. GST would not be exempt just because you are government or a charitable society. Unless you there is an exemption notification, a list is given. If it's public services, local authorities, etc., etc., if you fall in those entries, you get the exemption. So therefore, I would rather go back and check for any exemption is created for RWS, etc. Otherwise, purely because you are RWS, the theory of mutuality, etc., that was being litigated for a long time, right? Now, in the context of GST. If even as a society, right, you are saying that I am a member of society also and I am the recipient also. You are saying both service provider and service recipient are the same.
Yes.
Why there should be a tax? I am giving an example for you. I have got a shop in Delhi. I have got a shop in Ghaziabad. I am the same owner, same PAN number. But if I send my goods from Delhi to Ghaziabad, I jolly well pay the IGST. Same thing applies because it's. Earlier there was thing, I mean, you file Form F and all stock transfers were exempt, so therefore people were having warehouses throughout the country.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the day GST came in, 1st July 2017, lakhs of warehouses were closed throughout the country.
If it is a part of the chain of the manufacturing, even then?
Yes.
Like
I mean, it doesn't matter. Supply, even for free of cost, supply to yourself also is taxable. Look, you may take, it's a neutral exercise. I'll tell you how. When you are transferring from your Delhi plant to Baroda plant, right? It's from left pocket to right pocket. The money is only getting transferred from one Senvad account to the other Senvad account. It's just prepayment of tax. Eventually, you'll sell from there. This can be used as a credit. It's only finance cost, interest cost which you'll use. But there's no other liability. You're just paying it in advance.
No.
Government doesn't want to get into any other hassle.
So
they say if the goods are moving,
if I know and declare that I take from pocket A to pocket B, both places I pay,
yes,
but subsequently I withdraw from pocket A.
Yes.
Why should that exercise?
No, but that is because to maintain the chain, na, the input credit chain would get broken. So they said that we just don't care. We want to go on one concept called supply, whether for consideration or not.
Anything just, is out just of the pocket.
One minute. Yes. The example which you have given, you have two shops, one in Delhi, another is in Ghaziabad.
Correct.
Assuming that you have two shops in Delhi itself.
Then there is no, because yes, the same registration is there.
Correct.
Right, because two states are involved, na? They want to play a fair game. The state which is consuming it should get the tax. How will it get the tax?
It's not for the consumption.
No, look, it may consume. Factory B may just eat it. It may be idlis. Factory A produces idlis in its canteen. It goes to the other state and they eat it. It's consumed that state. Where is the tax gone? You say that I produce, I ate, I am a self-sufficient. I mean, village, rural economy, that can't, they say supply is supply. I mean, that's the law, I can't help it.
No, I know, the spill is bad. The spill out is bad, of course. I simply say that if you are a manufacturer, I make one thing, it goes to point B, they do some processing, it comes back to me.
Then again, he'll raise an invoice.
Like Sony used to do, their things were manufactured at different houses.
Correct.
Everything is collected. The whole day the transaction is there. Hmm. If it was GST to be collected, even for
the small then I'll answer you. Then there is a separate concept called job work.
That's
a different thing.
Yeah.
That's a different thing. No, job work has got different things.
Jewelry, it goes
within 1 year it has to come back.
Hmm?
Within 1 year it has to come back.
Okay.
Tax is paid by the raw material supplier, not by the job worker.
Okay. Right? So you say it's
on the
goods.
There's an exception credit for these things and a job work heading.
I'm sorry. Act.
Yes, yes. In the act. In fact, in the book also, there's a chapter dedicated to job work. You can read that. Capital.
He wants to ask. Yes.
GST refunds. Look, whenever you pay any tax by mistake, right? You were not. There were no transaction, but you ended up paying tax, or you're exporting some goods out of India and on payment of tax, right? So you get to, you are eligible for refund. So you follow the procedure, you file for refund, you get the refund. That's as simple as that. So whenever you're paying tax by fault, by default, or by mistake, or when you're exporting, or any other kind of zero rated supplies, or for example, input credit. When I'm exporting, the input credit lying in my account, I'm eligible for refund. That also.
Yeah, please, Rahul.
GST is applied on all the services and goods, right?
Yeah.
Suppose from the Play Store I download an application, so that they are providing me the services.
Correct.
That is the free application. I download it. They never invoice me. So how then the GST?
As a consumer, why are you concerned? The levy is on the.
That's what I'm asking. How will the government will find out? Can look home.
If they want to find out, they can find out anything.
No, actually.
So. Okay.
Daily lakhs of customers are downloading
maybe,
the services.
Maybe.
They're using the services.
Today, look, there's something called law, something called practicality.
Practicality.
The government, whether it wants to catch hold of this, why did they reduce taxes on housing? How did they? Why did they reduce taxes on this particular restaurants? It's because they want to protect the common man. At the end of the day, the thought process is that you just tax the persons who can pay tax and make them also.
Ultimately, consumers are, we are the consumer, we are downloading the application, we are using their services, so ultimately we have to pay the tax.
You have to bear the tax.
Bear the tax, yes.
Payment will be by them.
Yes,
they'll collect
the
it
tax.
From you.
The so, from, yeah. So like here, we are not bearing any tax.
No tax.
This is evasion.
No, I mean, look. That's what I'm saying. It's a policy level what they want to tap, what they don't want to tap, etc. It's only, I mean, look, largely it is because of to maintain the input credit flow and the interstate issues. It's because of this kind of things have come in. It was unheard of, these kinds of concepts. Even we are learning. It's a big task to unlearn and learn. Unlearning is the biggest task.
And then from the consumer point of view, how do you analyze whether it's a beneficial or not? You have said about the taxation aspect. Interstate.
From the consumer point of view, how it is beneficial, I'll tell you. Sir, can I have one meeting? Can we have one meeting? So, from the consumer point of view, I told you that with multiple taxes, multiple procedures, because everything, you have to have different registrations, different person would come take hafta, you have to pay tax there, you have to pay interest there, so many things, right? And litigation, right? Evasion, so all those costs, who will bear? Ultimately, all the cascading effect lands on the consumer's shoulder. But with this kind of thing, with the chain, which is unbroken chain, and GSTN, etc., once it becomes perfect, I mean, it may take 1 year, 2 years, whatever, the consumer's interest would be subserved by the fact that the rates would come down. The rates also have gotten neutralized, right? And also the value addition is applied to all types of events. Earlier, import, apna, like, he's singing differently. Manufacturer is different, service is different, entry is different. So therefore, there was no talking point. Those things were not available. If you're getting some goods out of Maharashtra, taking it to Gujarat, putting it into Kandla, it's going, right? So therefore, entry tax which you are paying, right, that was not available as credit. It's a cost. So who will bear the cost ultimately? No manufacturer will bear the cost. It will be transferred to the customer. So therefore, your goods would be much more expensive. So with the GST coming in, definitely it will be beneficial for the consumer in the longer run. Okay. So in my view.
At the source you pay when it is consumed.
Correct.
Where are you supposed to pay?
Pardon me?
At the source you are supposed to pay in advance.
You are just consumed. Look, you never know where it will be consumed. The assumption is, in the first transaction, the supplier is supplying and the recipient is consuming. The assumption. So therefore, whichever state is relevant state will collect the tax, right?
Relevant means at the point of
time. I'm coming to it. So therefore, the moment that transaction is not stopping there, it's getting into the second leg. The state which has collected it will transfer to the second state. So it's like that. It's like frisbee. I give you that state. Transfers it to it. With the goods and services, the tax also will get transferred.
No, if you produce 100 things, unfortunately, only 60 are sold.
Correct.
40 have gone waste because there is nothing, no client or
the tax is only on supply, not on manufacture. If you are wasting, then there is no tax. There is no tax.
No,
simple. I said only one concept you need to keep in your mind: supply. If you have supplied. And please look at the definition of supply in the GST Act. It will make it very clear. Different kinds of, even barter is supply.
No, it has perished.
I give my mobile and take your mobile.
Consume. Huh? Yeah. I manufacture something and for the transit it goes up to destination B where it was supposed to have been consumed.
Correct.
Only 60% is consumed.
No, that is not relevant. How much is consumed? Right? So you are getting into the economics of it. Now tax. Though it's a subject of economics, nobody would want a wild goose chase to see how much is consumed, really. You may waste it or whatever, it is deemed to be consumed.
Okay.
Further, we move forward.
Yeah.
Now it's almost 4 o'clock. Why they are regularly exempting several items?
Because of the public demand and representations being brought in. I mean, because of the in public interest.
Yeah. Further, we'll move forward because already it's going to be 4 o'clock.
Actually, I need to
know what is the jurisdiction
and the jurisdictional jurisdiction about this GST, and more of the limitation.
Look,
if
as far as appeals
is, we used to file the
GST.
How it will cover in the
look as far as the concept of good boy, bad boy. If you are a good boy, in the meaning that you have not done any fraud, no misrepresentation, no collusion with the departmental officers, right? If you are a good boy, then the limitation is 18 months plus 18 plus close to 2 years limitation. As against it used to be 1 year earlier, it became 18 months. They kept changing it. But if you're a bad boy, in the means that you're playing fraud in the department, you're concealing something, you're misrepresenting something, you're colluding with the departmental officers, then that becomes 6.5 years. They can go up backwards up to 6.5 years. That's a larger period of limitation. That is the limitation aspect. As far as picking the jurisdiction is concerned, in the original proceedings there is nothing, but if you want to file an appeal to the tribunal, right, it is 50,000 rupees. If your value of the transaction or dispute is lower than 50,000 rupees, you can't carry an appeal.
Appeal
to tribunal, right? And then you say territorial, right? Every state has got, if it's a state SGST issue, the state GST authorities will proceed against you, and there's a state tribunal, regional tribunals are there, then there's central tribunals are there, then national tribunal is there, High Court, Supreme Court. So therefore, I think we have fairly covered a lot of things. So as far as goods are concerned, there are about almost 1300 goods which are covered in the GST Act, and services, almost 500 services right? And slabs are nil, 0%, 5%, 12%, 18% and 28% for both goods and services. Now on 0% GST, it's about 7% of the goods are covered under this slab. I'm talking about goods. So which are examples? Unpacked food grains, fresh vegetables, unbranded atta, good milk, eggs, curd, lassi, health services, etc. are all nil. 5% GST is on 14% of the goods, number of items. It is on items like sugar, tea, edible oils, packed paneer, cashew nuts, footwear. Footwear up to 500 rupees MRP. Poor man's footwear. Apparel also 500 rupees. Right? All this is 5% GST. Now 12% GST is 17% of the goods are covered under this slab. What are these? Butter. Bread pe butter lagana is 12% dena padega. Ghee, almonds, fruit juice, umbrella, mobiles, etc. under the 12%. So I'm just giving examples which all touches. Then 18% GST is 43% of the goods are covered under this slab. Maximum goods are covered under this slab. So hair oil, toothpaste, soap, pasta, cornflakes, computers, printers, all these are under 18%. Right. Then services which got costlier after GST are courier services, courier services, mobile bills, insurance premiums, bank charges, broadband services, salon visits, all these have, restaurant we have spoken already, right? And housing also we have spoken. So I think we should have more questions now. I think we have fairly covered
no GST. If we ask some more questions, could say no GST applies now. You can ask now.
Sir, liquor pe kitne percent?
Haan ji.
I said 0%.
Liquor pe sir, liquor jo alcohol hai, wo GST pe nahi aata hai. Constitution mein GST ka definition
alcohol and petroleum.
Petroleum, nahi. Petroleum ka alag kahani hai. Article 366(12A) of the Constitution defines GST to mean any tax on supply of goods or services or both except tax on supply of alcoholic liquor for human consumption. Constitution mein. जहाँ तक आपकी पेट्रोलियम प्रोडक्ट्स की बात है वो अभी नहीं कलेक्ट कर रहे हैं सो उसके लिए पार्लियामेंट के पास जाने की जरूरत नहीं है बट फॉर अल्कोहल इट्स अ स्टेट सब्जेक्ट इट रिमेन अ स्टेट सब्जेक्ट सो सेंट्रल एक्साइज एक्ट अप्लाइज स्टिल अप्लाइज टू टोबैको एंड जीएसटी ऑल्सो अप्लाइज टोबैको पेट्रोलियम प्रोडक्ट्स ओनली सेंट्रल एक्साइज एक्ट अप्लाइज राइट अल्कोहल ओनली स्टेट एक्साइज अप्लाइज सो दिस इज द
हाँ
वो तो स्टेट 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 सब्जेक्ट है स्टेट स्टेट सब्जेक्ट
है नॉट सेंट्रल बिहार में अवेलेबल नहीं है लेक के जाना
पड़ेगा
हाँ जी
वन सैशे ऑफ 10 ग्राम The same thing of 100 m is very different.
There's no difference.
So I've seen somebody has given a presentation. If you buy a toothpaste, a village pack of 1 rupee, it is collectively 60 grams. So 60 gram pack is costlier than you buy 60 sachet of 1 rupee.
So because that is because of the manufacturing cost. And there may be a possibility that the government has issued an exemption notification for sachets. For will to
that
we can check. I mean, what is the rate on sachets? That is quite possible because people like you and me will go to the finance minister and request him, please do something about this.
Yes. Small packs are cheaper. Yes. Less packs.
It is cheaper to manufacture in a sachet. The sachet does not cost you much. The bottles cost you higher.
Sir, what is the reason the alcohol is not being made as a common?
Because states are not allowing. That's a major revenue source for states. States. I mean, there are so many wishful thinking can be there, but we must keep in mind that India is the highest rate of GST around the world. 18% is the high. I mean, whatever rates we have, is the highest rate.
Even when we have elections.
I think any new person want to raise a question, not regular one. Otherwise, we'll close this year. Thank you very much, Srinivas. I request Ruma Pathak to give vote of
confidence. Thank you so much, sir, for giving me this opportunity. I am myself Ruma Pathak. Thank you so much, sir,
thank you.
For your speech, which have already enlightened us. And I was not so much interested in GST, but you have given me many examples so that I could understand it properly. Thank you so much, sir.
I'm very, very grateful for the patient interaction. I say it interaction. Like we were talking, both of us were talking. And thank you, Seshu sir, for the wonderful opportunity with the colleagues of the bar. I'll cherish
even
this.
I am very close to him last 20 years, but I am not aware of his so much expert in tax.
No, thanks. You have clarified.
Fingers, everything is in your
water fingers. Level you clarified. Think, all ambiguity goes.
Mr. Arun Jaitley should take your advice. And when this thing advises yeah, something
it's a
like
big work.
So nice of you, Srinivas. I mean, such a wonderful.
So this is
really
for the group.
This is for the group.
No, great. No, but one thing you have not clarified. Instead of Gabbar Singh tax, you said I referred this.
Yeah,
you are not clear.
I am my GST is a hero. It's not Gabbar Singh.
Then
does he look like Gabbar Singh of Solo?
Something is to be said about the hero.
Like,
you have not said.
About Superman.
We'll circulate into the
no, I mean, I'll take 2 minutes for
yes,
this.
Yes, yes, yes.
I mean, actually, I was like, I'll give you a background as to how. I mean, I was studying also. I'd done a lot of degrees and all. My concept was to understand whether I read Adam Smith's original theory or Dukki or something. It should get into my mind. So that kept in my mind that because if I understand, then it stays. And now the children and we also, we get into that zone of just trying to ape instead of understanding things.
Correct.
So therefore, it has been made so complex. GST means Hawa. Right, when it is very simple, the concepts, if you conceptually, if you pick it up, you can build on that. So therefore, my intention was to twofold. One, simplify the entire concept into palatable parts, and also visual effect is very, very huge. If you see a movie, if you see cartoons, if you see, seeing is believing. And text, too much of text also takes you to sleep. So therefore,
like this,
it's a comic book.
It's a
comic
book. It's very interesting.
Comics.
It's
very comic.
Good.
Yeah. Further also.
It's available in the shop?
Yeah, it's on Amazon. It's available. Shops also, it's going to be available shortly.
Okay.
Right now, it's a coffee table version. So one student version also, we are bringing in a month or so.
Okay. Extremely
so I mean my dream was to make it I mean how to make it simple so therefore this came to my mind and I just
no it's created more curiosity when he has shown the
yeah.
Even children will get attracted
even my daughter she finished it she knows GST now.
Oh, wow.
In 10th standard
we'll take your autograph Mark. Last page will take your message whatever we have here we'll have signature autograph next page message
I'll be circulating this note or I can even leave this if you can photocopy and then or on the group I'll circulate
we expect generally from you freely
okay sir can I
write message from there correct? Generally we expect from speaker freely.
Equally tough to all.
Majburi.
Or you send in a PDF format.
Yeah, PDF.
Then that's a good. Correct?